This is my M1 Pro MacBook Pro I bought back in 2021, and it's been an absolute workhorse. It's edited almost every YouTube video on this channel, most of them in Final Cut Pro. I don't do anything crazy, but I do need a machine that can keep up with me. And after 4 years, this thing is finally starting to show its age. Real-time playback stutters, exports take longer, and that spinning beach ball, yeah, it's visiting a little bit too often. The new M5 MacBook Pro just came out, so I grabbed one to see how Apple's newest chip stacks up against my 4-year-old M1 Pro. And for reference, I'm also going to compare it to this M4 chip from my Mac Mini, because this thing has been a perfect balance of price and performance for what I do. So in this video, I'm putting my new M5 MacBook Pro up against my M1 Pro MacBook Pro and my M4 Pro Mac Mini. No synthetic benchmarks, just real-world editing in Final Cut Pro to see if this new M5 MacBook Pro can actually replace my current laptop, or if I should be waiting for the M5 Pro or even the M5 Max models coming later. On paper, the new M5 sits right between my M1 Pro MacBook Pro and the M4 Pro Mac Mini. But specs never tell a whole story. What really matters is how these machines perform when I'm actually editing videos. And before we jump in to see what they can do, let me show you the project I'm using to test all three. I wanted something that reflects my real workflow, not a synthetic benchmark. So I'm using my latest YouTube video with Multicam A-Roll, 6K B-roll, color grading, titles, effects, and all the stuff I usually throw at Final Cut Pro. To keep things fair, all the files are stored directly on the internal SSD of each machine, so an external drive isn't a bottleneck. Background render is turned off, and all render files have been deleted. This is the kind of timeline I work with every day, and it's a perfect way to see how each Mac handles real editing performance. First up is timeline performance, because at the end of the day, this is what really matters most. If your timeline isn't smooth and responsive, it affects everything. I started with my M4 Pro Mac Mini just to set a baseline, and on this machine, timeline performance was basically flawless. Navigation was smooth and responsive, and I could drop the playhead anywhere in my timeline, hit play, and it would start instantly with perfectly smooth playback. The only thing I noticed was a slight stutter in a scrolling timeline when moving through sections loaded with effects, but actual playback never struggled. My M1 Pro MacBook Pro, the machine I'm trying to replace, didn't hold up nearly as well. Simple parts of the project played just fine, but anything with effects or transitions caused playback to stutter and skip frames, which isn't a great experience. And then there's a new M5 MacBook Pro. Timeline performance on this thing was flawless. No matter what I threw at it, heavy effects or not, it didn't skip a beat. And honestly, it even performed better than my M4 Pro Mac Mini. So overall, the M4 Pro did great with just a tiny scroll hiccup. The M1 Pro struggled with anything heavier, and the M5 delivered perfectly smooth playback across the entire project. Before we jump into the next test, I want to give a huge thank you to Ugreen for sponsoring today's video and for sending over their new Ugreen DH2300. If you followed the channel for a while, you know how important backups are in my workflow, especially after I accidentally erased an external drive a few months ago. So having a proper backup system is a big deal for me. The DH2300 is basically your own personal cloud, but faster, more secure, and with no monthly fees. Everything is stored locally on your own hard drives instead of on someone else's server. For editors like me, who work with huge 4K and 6K files, this thing is a lifesaver. It supports up to 60 terabytes of storage, which is enough for 20 million photos or around 40,000 movies. So you'll never run out of space. And if you're sharing this NAS with your family or team members, you can set flexible access permissions for different accounts. That means everyone only sees and uses the folders they're supposed to, keeping your data organized and secure. One of my favorite features is how easy it is to back everything up. It can automatically back up your iPhone photos, or you can use it for Time Machine backups on your Mac. And if you're on your phone, you can even connect instantly with NFC. Just tap and you're in. Plus, you can access your files quickly for pretty much anything. Windows, macOS, Android, iOS, even your TV. So no matter what device you're on, everything is right there. Setup is super simple, even if you've never touched a NAS before. The interface walks you through everything, and you can be up and running in just a few minutes. And because everything is on your local network, the speeds are way faster than cloud storage. The DH2300 can hit up to 125 megabits per second, which means you can transfer a 1 gigabyte file in just a few seconds. perfect when you're moving around projects or backing up finished videos. So if you want to finally take control of your storage and backups, check out the link in the description. Ugreen is running a 20% off Black Friday offer from November 20th to December 1st. All right, let's get back into the tests. Another test I run on every machine is how well it can play through an entire project. I do this before exporting to catch any mistakes, and continuous playback can be surprisingly demanding. This is often where the older machines start to show their weakness. My Mac Mini started out great on this 13-minute project. Even the scrolling timeline mostly kept up, only stuttering slightly in sections with heavy effects. Around the 7-minute mark, the audio waveform stopped generating. It just couldn't keep up anymore. I also have a 360 clip in this project, and the scrolling timeline definitely fell behind during that part, but it never skipped frames. The only place I saw any stutter in the actual playback was right at the end of the video during a couple of my animation presets. Overall, really solid performance. Once again, the M1 Pro didn't do nearly as well. The scrolling timeline started falling behind around the 1-minute mark and just got worse the deeper I got into the project. About 4 minutes in, playback started getting choppy, and Final Cut Pro began dropping frames, especially in the sections with multiple layers of 6K video. By the 5-minute mark, things really started to fall apart, with dropped frames during pretty much any effect or animation, even the simple ones. Without rendering, this timeline is basically unwatchable on the M1 Pro. And just like before, the M5 MacBook Pro was flawless here. I saw a couple of moments where a scrolling timeline stuttered a bit, but playback itself never struggled at all. And even though it's close, the base M5 chip actually performed better than the M4 Pro. To wrap up this section, the M4 Pro handled the full project playback with just a few small hiccups. The M1 Pro fell apart quickly on the heavier sections, and the M5 stayed smooth from start to finish, even edging out the M4 Pro. With playback done, the next thing I wanted to test was export performance, starting with exporting this unrendered project. I'm using an Apple Devices 4K preset because for me, it's the perfect balance between file size and quality. And for whatever reason, this codec seems to process the fastest and give me the least amount of issues when uploading to YouTube. On the M4 Pro Mac Mini, this 13-minute project exported in about 7.5 minutes, which is exactly what I expected. When I tried the same export on my old M1 Pro MacBook Pro, it actually got stuck at 87% the first time. I had to force quit Final Cut, reopen it, and try again. The second attempt worked, but the export took almost 15 minutes. The new M5 MacBook Pro was much closer to the Mac Mini. It finished in 7 minutes and 47 seconds, just slightly slower. Looking at the results, the M4 Pro Mac Mini set the baseline at roughly 7.5 minutes. The M1 Pro took almost double that time, and the M5 landed very close to the M4 Pro, finishing only about 4% slower and roughly 48% faster than the M1 Pro. Next up is render times, because sometimes you have to render a project, or at least certain sections, to get smooth playback, especially on older machines. Rendering this entire 13-minute project on the M4 Pro Mac Mini took about 6 minutes and 10 seconds, which is pretty solid. My old MacBook Pro took almost twice as long, finishing the render in 11 minutes and 44 seconds. And as expected, the new M5 MacBook Pro was the fastest, finishing in 6 minutes and 7 seconds, just a touch quicker than the M4 Pro. In short, the M4 Pro Mac Mini delivered a strong render time at just over 6 minutes. The M1 Pro lagged far behind, and the M5 came out on top, only slightly faster than the M4 Pro, but massively ahead of the older M1 Pro. Since my project was already rendered, I also wanted to test the export speed of the rendered timeline. For this one, I chose the export file preset using Apple's ProRes 422 codec, which is the same codec Final Cut Pro uses to render files. It means no transcoding, just raw export speed. The M4 Pro Mac Mini exported this timeline in 2 minutes and 12 seconds. The M1 Pro finished in 3 minutes and 50 seconds. And the M5 MacBook Pro landed right in between, finishing in just over 3 minutes. Breaking down these results, the M4 Pro was clearly the fastest. The M5 followed closely behind, and the M1 Pro rounded out the bottom. The M5 didn't take first place here, but it was still about 20% faster than the M1 Pro. Next, I wanted to see how fast these machines could transcode a clip to optimized and proxy media. For this test, I used a 5.5-minute 6K Panasonic Vlog clip, a pretty demanding codec. The M4 Pro Mac Mini handled it easily, transcoding this clip to optimized and proxy media in about 38 seconds. The M1 Pro MacBook Pro did this in just under 2 minutes. And once again, the M5 MacBook landed right in the middle in around 1 minute and 20 seconds. Overall, the M4 Pro Mac Mini dominated this test at 38 seconds. The M5 MacBook Pro gave a noticeable improvement over the M1 Pro, finishing about 35% faster. But still, it wasn't even close to the M4 Pro's speed. The M1 Pro, again, was the slowest. Next, I wanted to put the Neural Engine to the test by trying out some of Final Cut Pro's newer AI features. The first one I tested was Smooth Slow-Mo, where Final Cut Pro slows down a clip and uses AI to generate the extra frames needed for smooth playback. For this test, I took an 8-second 4K clip and slowed it down to 25% of the original speed. On the M4 Pro Mac Mini, the analysis took about 34 seconds, and playback was perfectly smooth with no need for rendering. My old M1 Pro MacBook Pro was noticeably slower, taking 51 seconds to analyze the same clip. Playback was choppy until I rendered it. The new M5 MacBook Pro was actually the fastest at around 30 seconds, but just like the M1 Pro, it needed rendering for smooth playback. In this case, the M4 Pro gave the best real-time playback, the M5 had the fastest analysis, and the M1 Pro struggled on both fronts. The last test I ran was using Magnetic Mask, where Final Cut Pro uses AI to automatically rotoscope a subject. Using the same clip, the M4 Pro finished in about 1 minute and 15 seconds. The M1 Pro took just under 2 minutes. And the M5 was the fastest again at around 1 minute and 10 seconds. So, for the Magnetic Mask, the M5 pulled into the lead, the M4 Pro stayed close behind, and the M1 Pro rounded out the bottom. After putting all three of these machines through the paces, here's what I learned. The M1 Pro MacBook Pro has been a great laptop for years, but it's definitely starting to struggle with modern workflows, especially with high-resolution footage and AI-powered tools. It still works, but it's showing its age. The M4 Pro Mac Mini was solid across the board. In most tests, it either matched or came close to the M5, and in a few situations, like smooth slow-mo playback, it actually performed better. For the price, it's still one of the best values for Final Cut users. And then there's the new M5 MacBook Pro. In all my tests, it either matched the M4 Pro or beat it, all in a portable form factor. Considering this is the base M5, the performance is seriously impressive. Now, for me personally, even though the base M5 is amazing and easily the best value, I tend to keep my laptops for a long time. So, to future-proof my setup, I'll probably hold out and wait for the M5 Pro or even the M5 Max when those models come out. I like getting the most powerful machine I can reasonably afford, especially since my laptop is such a big part of my workflow. But if you're looking for the best performance per dollar right now and you need a laptop, the base M5 MacBook Pro is honestly hard to beat. If you want to see the full list of apps I install on my new MacBook Pro, or the accessories I use to set up my editing workflow, those videos are linked in the description. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.